Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Navneet Sharma. I am Dean of the Business School at the Vijay Bhumi University. And I have great pleasure in introducing to you a distinguished guest for this webinar, Dhwanil Sheth. We are going to have a conversation about traversing from being a professional to a startup. Dhwanil studied as a chartered accountant. He qualified as a chartered accountant and subsequently worked at BCG for 3 years. And subsequently, after that, he set up a startup with the name Skillmatics. Why we are talking about this, let me spend a few minutes to build the context. All of us have a fundamental question of searching our path. And that path, particularly in the current times, it becomes very, very important for the simple reason that the current times are very, very disruptive. In one word, what we, in popular media, what we hear, Industry 4.0, the future of business and education is facing tremendous disruptions. There are technology-driven disruptions in market structures. The gig economy is witnessing emergence of new business models. You never heard a variety of products and services being delivered in the way they are being delivered now. You never had an Ola, an Uber, a Zomato, or a Swiggy earlier. But you have a variety of services from house renting to infrastructure to variety of products to services to Book My Show to everything. They are being available now, variety of startup. So therefore, that has posed a significant question for us who are responsible for educating the youth. And therefore, this series as a university, Vijay Bhumi University, has a commitment to study these disruptions and allow understanding or in comprehension of these issues to you. Let me pose a first question to Dhwanil. How in his mind, how evolution of work has taken place? Dhwanil, can I invite your reflection on the evolution before we proceed ahead?
Firstly, thank you so much for having me. It's a real honor to speak to all of you here. I think I can answer that from my personal lens. And I think one of the advantages of being a younger founder and an entrepreneur in this generation is that you aren't constrained with limitations of how the world used to operate. And as Sir rightly mentioned, I think we're living in an era of accelerated change. I think the fundamental shift between now and, say, the previous generation is that the world is changing at a much faster rate than ever before. And if you think about how our parents were educated, I mean, they were very set paths. You know, you became a lawyer, you became a doctor, you became an engineer, you worked in one company for 20 years. I think all of that is completely obsolete in today's world. And in every 2 to 3 years, you're going to see dynamic shifts in the way the world operates. And I think a large reason for that is just the speed of technological adoption. And you see it everywhere, right? In your field, sir, you see it in education. You'll see education moving online. In our startup, for example, we're building a global brand from India, which historically was simply not possible, because how do you reach consumers in the US market? How do you engage? How do you sell to them? But today, with, you know, channels like Amazon, I can sit in India and build a brand in America. I think fundamentally the world is being reshaped by technology. You're going to see disruption in every single industry, and it's going to change everything. The way we study, the way we live, the way we work. We're obviously in the middle of some pretty unprecedented times currently. Most businesses are still operational. I think it's been a forced shift to operate from home. I think coming out of this, you're going to see, you know, the way people work fundamentally change. I think that's going to be very, very exciting. I think that's perhaps my personal view on it, is that, you know, you can't adopt as static a lens anymore. And I just think that the world is changing very, very rapidly, very, very frequently. And technology is the primary driver of this change.
You know, one of the central questions is that, what is my passion? Our audience today, many of the young students, they are seeking two things: a discovery of passion, and then how do I align my passion with my work, with my education? This is one set of questions the audience is seeking answers to. The second question is, even if I know, even if I discovered what my passion is, how do I prepare for my chosen path? Be it a professional career, be it a career of an entrepreneur, or be it anything else, or a combination of the two, whatever you choose. These are two central questions. And with your life journey, Dhwanil, we want to understand how our audience can comprehend these two issues and find their own path. With this, let me first invite you, Dhwanil, to provide us a perspective. Please tell us briefly what your journey has been. Please tell us about your education and initial career so that audience can know you a little better.
I think I relate very strongly with the audience, and I think that, you know, I come from the same generation fundamentally. I think my personal background, I grew up in India, in Bombay. I studied at a school called Cathedral and John Connon School. I did my 10th and then I did my 11th, 12th in commerce. Actually, very early on, I always tried to take decisions what I felt was right versus what people wanted me to do. I remember after finishing my ICSE, like, there was a lot of societal pressure that, you know, if you're a smart student, you have to take science. I mean, I don't even understand that logic. I always went by what I thought was the right thing. My passion always was, you know, more around numbers, around business, around how businesses are built. You know, coming from a business family, personally, I think I was exposed to that at a very young age. So I think I took the path of commerce. I did eventually, after my 12th, I chose to do my CA. I did that parallelly with my BCom and subsequently my MCom as well. I had the fortune of, like, you know, doing pretty well in my exams. And I think that's one of the great opportunities of a quality education. It opens up a lot of opportunities for you.
In terms of your self-discovery, Dhwanil, do you recollect any particular incidents in your career, in your school, any particular experience where you thought that entrepreneurship was for you? Is there any particular experience which you can recount for us?
That's a good question. I think there's just off the top of my head, there's one that comes straight to mind. I remember when we were in 10th standard, actually. That's going back that. They're probably the first memory I have of it. And my elective subject was commerce. Our professor, who was, you know, always a believer in hands-on learning versus unpractical learning versus just bookish and theoretical knowledge, he divided the class into teams of, I believe, five or six. And we had 1 month to come up with an entire business plan to run one of the stalls in the canteen. So we could choose anything from a dosa counter to a sandwich counter to a juice stall. And the objective was very clear, which team can maximize profits. And the team members had to all chip in their pocket money as seed capital. So it was a great lesson, because in that little experiment, it was like we learned everything of practically how you run a company, from financing the business to thinking of what is the product line you want to start with, how do the economics of that product line work, where will we maximize margin, how will we then market this product. So we ran a dosa counter, and the whole idea of, and we didn't even win that competition, to be honest. But I think it taught me two things, like building something and how rewarding that can be from a personal fulfillment perspective. And second, learning to live with a little bit of failure. Actually, I think we came like second last in that competition. I think that was something from my school days, which always made me realize that this is a path I would perhaps want to take one day.
But when you completed your chartered accountancy, what were the initial thoughts of starting your career? How did you start there?
So I think that's a fair point. I think even after completing my CA, you know, I was tempted to start something. But I think, you know, it's very easy to glamorize entrepreneurship, to make it sound that, you know, everyone should just run into it. I think the truth is it's an extremely difficult path. It's a very lonely path. You know, you see failure up close on a daily basis, very honestly. And I think that I always wanted to have a solid background, and that's a backup almost. And I think that that's something I would encourage any student I speak to today, that, you know, even if you want to pursue entrepreneurship, professionalism, I mean, honestly, anything, even working at a startup, building a very strong foundation early on in your career with the combination of a quality education and, you know, some solid professional work experience will really give you a fallback in, you know, irrespective of what may happen in the future. And so my decision was that, look, I had the opportunity to luckily work at BCG, which was a leading global multinational corporation. And I think the decision for me was, look, here's an opportunity to get a marquee company on my resume. And, you know, having spent 3 years there working from India to Japan to North America, I literally worked across 4 or 5 countries. It gave me a lot broader perspective, and a lot of those skills that helped me, that I built during that time, helped me a lot in my business as well. So that's something I would always encourage people to think about, that, you know, while there's a merit of being young, ambitious and hungry, there's no substitute to learning in the real world. And taking some of that experience upfront early on also gives you a very strong foundation to fall back on if things don't work out as planned, right? And I think that's a very pragmatic way of thinking about it. And that's sort of the path that I took.
But when you were flying so high, doing well in BCG, at what point you were bitten by the startup bug?
I think So at least the path that I took, right? I think BCG is a leading consulting company. Global, you're talking to CEOs. I remember I was 24 years old and I remember giving a presentation to Uday Kotak one day. And that was like the highlight of my, like, you know, early days. I remember coming home and telling my parents that I just presented my idea to Uday Kotak. So yes, there was a lot of thrills of working at BCG, right? You know, any of these big companies, you get phenomenal exposure, you know, the thrills of working at the highest levels. But I think at a personal level, at least the job that I was doing was fundamentally giving advice, right? Giving advice to companies. And I think at some level, I always realized that, you know, it's very easy to give advice. Like, you know, it's, but the truth is, like, building something is infinitely harder. And I remember at that time, I actually came across a quote by Mukesh Ambani. It's a very random example. And he had quoted saying that, look, if you look at the world of cricket, there are players and there are commentators, and both are successful. It's not that one path is better than the other. But do you want to be Sachin Tendulkar or do you want to be Harsha Bhogle? My personal view is that, you know, it's a lot harder to become Sachin Tendulkar. But, you know, I have one life and I would rather try for something much, much harder than go for something which I believe is, you know, limiting my potential. So that was my personal view. Obviously, I was very naive, younger. And I think that was the reason I took that, look, I'm 25 years old at the time when I started. If there was ever a time where I had the ability to take risk, it was then. And that's one of the advantages of, you know, taking these calls earlier on in life, that you always can fall back. You have time as your friend, right? And so I guess some of it was a little bit naivety and some of it was a little thought out. But that's what made me actually take the leap and, you know, say that now is the time and let's go for it.
So when you were flirting with the idea of setting up a startup, how did you zeroed it on the idea of Skillmatics? Because you must have considered variety of ideas. I'm sure even on a conservative note, I would say you must have rejected at least 9 ideas to select Skillmatics. So what was that process like? Give us...
No, honestly, that's a very fair estimation. It's not that it's like an overnight switch, right? You're not saying that, okay, tomorrow I want to start a business and I'll start. In fact, I spent greater part of my last year while I was at BCG doing a lot of research on, you know, what is that idea? What is it that I want to build? While I was at BCG, I was actually doing a lot of consulting specifically around consumer businesses and retail businesses in the US. I was living personally in North America between New York and Toronto. And one thing that really sort of caught my attention is that most global brands, if you look at history, have been from America or Western Europe, and they percolated through the world. If you think of any leading consumer brand, that's typically how they've been built. And the biggest advantage of these brands was that they had access to the best market in the world. That's America, you know, high spending, rich country, deep, very deep, large markets. Company from India could never dream of building a global brand. So typically, if you look at Indian entrepreneurs in the last generation, they typically built manufacturing businesses, right? Because that was what we could do. We couldn't build consumer business. And as I looked at the environment that I was in, I felt all of those limitations, frankly, didn't exist. Today, sitting anywhere in the world, I can engage with consumers anywhere in the world. I can through Facebook, Instagram, today, TikTok, I can engage with consumers at a deep level and build my brand. That's one aspect of brand building. The second is distribution. Today, sitting anywhere in the world, I can sell products on Amazon. It doesn't matter where I am, honestly. And if you really think of the power of that, you can think of building global brands from India. And at a personal level, I felt that whatever business I started, the honest truth, I wanted to have some positive impact to India. It really pained me that there are very few brands that actually consumers use that come from India, right? If you think of it, there are hardly any global brands. And I felt like that's a pursuit worthy to, you know, go after. And then I started to think of, you know, which category could I build these brands in, you know? So a lot of brands naturally got ruled out because you couldn't build like a food and beverage brand naturally because of, you know, many constraints. And that's when I actually had a very anecdotal experience with my sister who lives in Singapore and my nephews. And I saw that, you know, how adamant she was to limit their exposure to screen time. And my nephew was around 3 years old at the time. And, you know, and I literally saw my own nephew who was 3 years old try to swipe a book like you would swipe a screen. And I saw that how my sister just lost her mind. They're saying that, you know, and how worried she was about her child's future and their excessive exposure to technology. And so I felt that this is a genuine problem. And if we can build a brand which could build products that help children build core cognitive skills and take them away from screens, it would be a very relevant brand in today's generation. And of course, it could be built globally. It could target a global audience. And that's sort of how, like, combination of factors helped me come up and build Skillmatics.
And then once you shortlisted this idea, you firmed it up, then I'm sure you must have looked for funding. So what kind of experience you had when you went to VCs and other funders, whatever you did? So give us, give us a sense of preparing, that preparation where you are not only conceptualizing your company, but also fleshing out the numbers so that you can present to the funding agencies with some amount of confidence, generate confidence in them that they feel like funding to them. Give us a sense of that process.
So that was a very difficult process, right? Let's be honest. It's very easy to read that, okay, Sequoia Capital has invested in us and all of that. But for that one Sequoia Capital, I must have been rejected 50 times. So I think, there's always a deeper story to these, to these headlines that people read. I think, honestly, first, we should start by understanding that we're in a very fortunate environment as young entrepreneurs. You know, if I go back a generation, there wasn't this sort of access to capital, which today's entrepreneurs have. You know, there is a very deep VC ecosystem now available in India to fund new age businesses and new age disruptive ideas. All of us as young people should be very grateful that that environment exists. Given that's the environment, a lot more people are willing to become entrepreneurs because they don't need to finance it. So there's a lot more competition for that precious VC capital. Through my process, and this is, a lot of it was learning, a couple of things that I've realized that VCs typically look for, right? They're really looking at an early stage for early stage companies for three things. One, how big is the market that you're going after? This business that you're building, it could be a good business, but is the market very small? So VCs aren't interested in funding even a very good business in a small market, because for them, that will not cut it. So you have to be thinking very big in terms of your addressable market opportunity. So for example, for us, we were thinking of building a global brand. So the size of the market opportunity is very, very big. If I had gone to VCs and saying that, I want to build an education company for metros in India, that would not have been exciting for them. I think one aspect is, how big are you thinking? How big is that market? What are the characteristics of the market? And for those of you who tend to become entrepreneurs in the future, I would spend a lot of time, even as you conceptualize your business, really thinking, are we going after a large market or not? Typically, businesses that operate in large markets tend to have a higher probability of success. The second aspect is, what are the characteristics of that market, right? I mean, it could be large, but is it dominated by a few people? Or is it a fragmented market, right? What are the competitive dynamics of that market? What are the margin structures in that market? You have to understand at a very deeper level. And so I think I spent a lot of time trying to understand and research around that. I think, again, my background at BCG and my prior studying as a CA helped a lot. And even business school graduates, for those of you who are at IFIM, a lot of that theoretical approaches actually come in a lot of use as you study the market and its characteristic. The second thing they're really evaluating is you, right, as a founder. It's always better to be a team. I'm unfortunately a single founder. Now I have a co-founder on board. But I think in general, if you are two people or three people, it's always better because it's very difficult early on. And they're evaluating the founder team and they're trying to understand that, does that founder team have complementary skill sets? So if one person is great at sales and marketing, is the other person great at technology? If you're starting a technology business, a lot of these things will be very helpful for those of you who start businesses in the future. And the last thing is, as you start your business, VCs have this term called product market fit. Is your business seeing that? Are consumers loving your product? And that product market fit could be defined in different ways for different types of businesses. So for example, for a consumer brand or a consumer product, they'll be looking at, what are the reviews for your products? Do consumers love your product? What is the kind of revenue you're seeing in your initial business? If you're a technology product, what is the sort of tricks you're seeing in terms of engagement, retention on your platform? So I think there are different ways to measure it, but there is effectively seeing that, look, what you built, is it seeing a fit in the market? Because if you are seeing product market fit at a small scale, you will see it at a bigger scale. And so I think, understanding some of these things will help you conceptualize your business and also prepare, because at the end of the day, you want to know what the other person wants. I sequentially got better at it. And very honestly, one thing I've realized, and it was perhaps the best tip I can give to anybody who's ever going to raise capital, is that, look, it doesn't matter if 49 people say no. It just takes one person saying yes for you to get millions of dollars in your bank account, right? That's something you should imbibe, that just never give up. It's a persistence game. You'll only get better.
So basically, for the audience, let me recap the three-pronged mantra a killer funding pitch, need to have number one, scale, number two, a great team, and number three, great complementarity in the team and the product market fit. I think these are four points we can take from your perspective on facing VCs. Coming back to Dhanil, so having set up the funding related aspects in place, how did you look at the operational things now? For a young person who hasn't really got a lifetime of experience, how do you handle the execution part of it? And then we also have a question from Rajiv Shah, who has inspired you the most?
To answer the first question, I honestly didn't know. That's the very honest answer. I think the advantage of being young and is that you don't have too much prior knowledge, right? I mean, you're doing things for the first time. So you tend to adopt a very first principles view on how to solve problems. So for example, like as you start getting into operational challenges and so on, you honestly just learn by doing and you learn from your mistake. You know, I've made every mistake possible. And I think the advantage of just operating in a startup is that, you know, you have to move very, very fast. And as you do that, you make more mistakes and you learn from it. And honestly, there's no playbook. I think you try and learn from doing. You try and take a very first principles approach, saying that, okay, logically, what is the best way to solve this? And I think the third thing is, you know, you try and rely on resources, right? Today, we're living in a world where there is an abundance of educational content. If you want to learn digital marketing, you can get 100 ways to learn it. I think this whole notion of education being something you complete and then you work is almost obsolete. Today, because the world is so dynamic, you have to constantly learn. So while I had no knowledge of digital marketing, I mean, I took 3 courses in it online and I learned. Having that mentality of being a lifelong learner, leveraging all this online education platforms you have, you know, you can pick up anything. You just need to have the right mentality for it.
And the inspiration, who inspired you the most?
Yeah, I think inspiration, I think there are two, right? I think at a very personal level, most kids, I think my dad is my biggest inspiration on multiple counts. You know, he's inspired me in my lifetime and not just in business, but I think as an overall role model, it's often not valued enough, but you know, having a strong support system allows you to take risks. Everything about how he built Amazon, principles he adopted, I think are a template for any business to follow. Amazon has 10 principles and you should just read about them. They're like a Bible for anyone building a business. Right. And I think if you just adopt those, the two things that really he has, which stuck, you know, really resonate with me is one, adopting a very customer centric view on your business. And the second, thinking very, very far. How do you take a 10, 15 year view on what you're building? So I think, I think those are my inspirations.
Remains that, you know, what can universities do in order to prepare graduates? You know, that is the central question we face. And what can management education, Kritika has asked a wonderful question. What are the key things that business education or management education must address in their curriculum to create more entrepreneurs in India?
Firstly, the starting point is India is a very unique society. I think we're a country of entrepreneurs. It's, I think, very intrinsic to who we are as Indians. If you really think about it, the majority of Indians are entrepreneurs. If you think of the guy running a pawn store, the guy running a retail store, they're all entrepreneurs. The truth is that's very intrinsic to who we are as people. However, I think especially our upper education is not geared to inspire that. That's my honest view, which is one of the reasons I didn't do an MBA. And I feel that that's a very big contrast to how like countries like America think. So if you look at US business schools, their entire framework, especially in MBAs and so on, is far more practical oriented than theoretical, right? I think in India, we tend to overemphasize learning theoretical concepts. And so I think what is important is for educational institutions to try and teach people real life skills. Like how can you start bringing in new relevant courses? For example, you know, data science, analytics, digital marketing. I mean, these are the skills people need to be learning. So I think one part is structurally shifting to more relevant skill sets than like, okay, learning about commerce. I mean, it's irrelevant, right? What is a joint stock company? What is a partnership? Is irrelevant. I personally feel like, are you teaching new unique skill sets? That's one approach. The second is, as you teach these newer skill sets, is your approach more theoretical or practical, right? Can you make students run real life case studies, run real life mini projects, get them exposed to small businesses. Can they intern at startups or other companies who are actually doing these things? Shifting the mindset to more practical approach will make a world of a difference. And the third bucket I would really think about deeply is, how do you make students realize that learning is not a one step process, that you are not just studying engineering to get into a good MBA and then you're doing MBA to get a good job? How can you teach people to be continuous learners? How do you build that skill set in people that they constantly learn? Because I guarantee you, 3 years from now, how are they going to learn the new skill sets that come up? And having that, I would say, mental model is very, very important.
But from your experience, Dhwanil, what we gather is that starting younger at a younger age is an advantage. That's something I'm alluding to, that lesson that, you know, starting early is better. So what can we do at the bachelor's degree level? What kind of approach, what kind of education, what kind of curriculum architecture can we do that people who are having aspirations to be entrepreneur, they are better facilitated?
The way I would view it is almost that starting point should be that, look, everyone doesn't need to be an entrepreneur. That's not the right answer. Everyone's journey, everyone's path is different to success, right? You can become a professional and become a CEO. Like Satya Nadella is not an entrepreneur, but, you know, one would argue he's extremely, extremely successful. If schools and, you know, colleges help to discover what you really are and who you are, and what that should be the framework you should adopt and adapt as an institution. Putting people in, you know, I would say environments where they're effectively like exposed to entrepreneurship will make them realize, is this really for them or not? And I think the starting point really needs to be that, you know, self-discovery. You know, is this something at that stage you want to do or even not do? Early on, if people start getting clarity on, you know, their journey and what is their purpose, one of the great things that colleges and schools can facilitate, you know, having sessions like this with young entrepreneurs, experienced entrepreneurs, like taking part in this, you will, like people viewing will feel something. Either they're inspired to do this or they're not. It's something very easy to judge.
Yeah, I think there are two questions. Both are functional questions. The first one is from Sonal Budwani. On what basis do you hire? I think as a young person, how do you deal with the recruitment related procedures?
So I think there are two ways to think of it, right? I mean, let me start early on. Early on, getting the first hire was a major challenge. I did all kinds of crazy things to get the first few people to join, right? Because why would someone join a company which has one person and no product and no money? So for example, it's like the ultimate salesman role. I remember early on, I literally called up all prospective candidates that I wanted, and I literally called them like a salesman, being like, this is why you should join my company. This is what it'll do. For those of them who agreed to interview me, I did all sorts of ridiculous things. Like I would have maybe a friend or someone sit in front of me to pretend like I'm conducting an interview so that people feel that there is competition for the role. Early on, you have to be very creative on how do you get people to join and really buy into your vision. But I think now, obviously, the challenges are very different. I think now that we are funded, we've got over 50 employees. I'm not even saying employees, colleagues working with us. I think the recruitment process is very different, right? I think there are plenty of people who want to join us. And I think that's the advantage of being a well-funded startup, is that everyone wants to work with you. Fundamentally, we're looking at really two or three things. We, one, don't have a very strict criteria, which is very unlike traditional companies, right? I believe like, you know, someone's intent and drive for me is the biggest indication of what will they fit into our company or not. So typically we look for three things. One, we prefer to have young people. So typically we look for young people. We look for people who are very hungry, people who are very determined to make a difference and an impact right now. I think you want that risk-taking ability even in your team, have that ability to, that hunger to drive. And thirdly, you know, we're looking for whatever that functional role is, we test very specifically on, do they have the raw materials for success or not?
Right. There's a second question from Professor Kamalika Chakraborty. She wants to know the benefits of building a vertically integrated supply chain in this particular product category you are dealing with. So this is a quintessential question for a businessman, what to do on one's own and how much to get done from outside. So how do you deal with this vertical integration question?
That's a great question. For those of you who may not know what vertically integrated supply chain is, basically that means that we as a brand control the entire process right to the point of production. So that's what being vertically integrated is. Like, we are from the point of production to the development of the product, we have full control over the supply chain. Why did we opt to build something like that, right? I think our competition is global brands and global players. And most 99% of global players don't own their supply chain. They are American companies or European companies, and they manufacture in like China or something. Now, because they have a structure like that, that's the norm in our industry, right? So because they have such a structure, their margins are much lower than our margins if you adopt a model which is vertically integrated. So think about the business we're building, right? We're building a business which is basically targeting US consumers, but at India cost price, because we manufacture and control the entire supply chain in India. Naturally, that business model has a far higher margin structure. So to put it in perspective, say if a company has X percent gross margin, we have 2X gross margin. So we're that much more profitable than them. The reason we took that was, one, you know, we would have a huge unfair advantage over competition. The second thing is, owning your supply chain allows you to go much faster than competition. So for example, you know how the retail industry was disrupted by Zara. And Zara basically, you know, moved to this fast fashion model, which was a game changer. And what that essentially means is, like, look, most companies in our industry take 12 months to develop a new product line and take it to market because they don't own their supply chain and they're slow. By owning our supply chain, we're able to design, develop, and launch products in 3 months. So think about that. We have twice the margins as them, and we can go 4 times faster than them from a product development standpoint. Those were some of the considerations we had in our mind, which made us opt for this model. So sometimes, you know, it's not the answer, but, you know, sometimes in our case it is, and it's given us a very unfair advantage, and it's helped us to, like, you know, rapidly grow our business and, you know, have a sustainable competitive advantage over our competition.
Nupur Kapadia has got a fantastic question. She's asking, how do you believe business will be impacted in the post-COVID-19 world? What kind of adverse effects, or what kind of structural shifts, or what kind of disruptions do you envision post-COVID-19?
This is a very real and a very pertinent question. And we're learning right now. You know, luckily our investors, Sequoia, have a global portfolio of companies across the US, India, and China. So we're learning a lot from our investors as well in what they're seeing. And I'm, you know, I'd love to share some of that with you all. One is that, you know, we're certainly heading for a recession. So that's not the best news, but that's the hard reality of it. 2020 is not going to be a great year for businesses across the world, because it's, you know, there is a huge economic toll to just shutting down the global economy the way the world has. I think what we're seeing in China across, you know, our sister companies that we see which are in China is that recovery has been pretty quick. So hopeful that India and the US and other markets see a similar recovery. The second thing is, I think that, you know, there's going to be dramatic shifts in how businesses operate. Let's take education. I think this is going to be a boom for online education. The same way demonetization led to mass adoption in digital payments, spurred the rise of fintechs, there's clearly going to be a dramatic shift in edtech companies, colleges, schools adopting online education platforms. I mean, you guys are honestly pioneers in your fact that you even have the IT infrastructure to conduct webinars like this for your students. I think that you will be in the 1% of schools and colleges and universities who have this infrastructure. We'll see marked shifts in consumer behavior, even the way we work. You know, India has this mentality of, like, let's meet. For everything, people want to meet. I think there'll be a dramatic change in how people work, and a lot more adoption for, you know, video meetings, video conferencing. And that has dramatic implications on, you know, what is the travel industry going to get hit? Like, are you going to be flying as much? You know, so I think there are sectors that are going to be very adversely impacted, specifically travel, hospitality, restaurants. But at the same time, there'll be winners and losers. So for those that lose, there'll be winners like online education, online delivery, food delivery. Unfortunately, that's the reality of it. So there'll be some who are very badly impacted and some who are very positively impacted.
But the headline is that what demonetization did to fintech companies, COVID-19 is going to do that to the education sector. That's the headline.
Without a doubt.
Absolutely. So we have a question from Dr. Giri Yogeshwari. Being a young entrepreneur in today's highly competitive business and digital world, what skill an entrepreneur must have to sustain, even to deal with situations like current?
I think there are three things I would say. I mean, honestly, like nothing I've ever done has prepared me for something like what we're facing today. And I think that's true for majority of entrepreneurs, even experienced ones. There are three things. One thing I've realized is that hope is not a strategy. The best strategy is to be bold and decisive in a time like this. Understand the environment, understand the implications for your business, and take decisions. You can't just sit and hope around. You should be everyone's mantra. Don't just sit around. You can't just hope for things. You have to make things happen. The second thing is just be positive, irrespective of COVID or non-COVID. As an entrepreneur, you have to be positive because it's such a brutal journey that unless you're positive and persistent in your mindset, to have that mentality, you should be able to overcome any obstacle. Be analytical, assess the situation and take a decision. Don't just sit around and hope, because that's the worst strategy in my opinion. And the second thing is, you know, have a positive and good outlook on, you know, how you can benefit from the situation, because every crisis has an opportunity, right? In our business, our India revenue has effectively gone to zero because stores are shut and online is shut. But our US business has skyrocketed, seeing 5x the growth because, you know, the entire country is locked down. So look for the opportunity and double down on where you can.
Let me quickly, in response to what you just, you know, mentioned here, let me quickly present to you what we are doing at Vijayabhoomi. What is the approach we are taking? So at Vijayabhoomi, we have certain practice courses. Let me give you one or two instances to explain what I mean. Say, the first touchstone we have is the famous multiple intelligences theory of Howard Gardner. We understand that what you also mentioned in your in several of your answers, that self-discovery is essential. So therefore, in order to facilitate that self-discovery at the L0 level, at the very first year, what we do is we offer courses from 8 different baskets. So a student is asked to choose two courses from each of these baskets and earn credit. The fundamental purpose of this entire process in the very first year is to discover what my strengths are. Without discovering that, I think any further pursuit of any choice of majors and minors or any decision regarding being a professional or being an entrepreneur could be hugely suboptimal. So therefore, the first year is a discovery year. In the second and third year, at the L1 and L2 level, what we are doing is, because our intention is to disrupt the higher education space, we are allowing what I would love to call unlimited freedom and choice. So what it means in simple language, that you can opt any majors and minors. You can basically, in simple language, carve out your own degree. If I can draw your attention to something like a subway experience, where for all practical reasons, you can carve out your own subway. You can exercise your choice in terms of bread, vegetables, sauces, everything. Exactly like that, we will allow students to exercise choices in terms of their majors and minors at L1 and L2 across the duration of the degree program, be it 3 years or 4 years or 5 years, depending on the which degree a student is choosing. There are practice courses such as SIP on the left bar. You can see the social immersion program. So give you an example. This is a 2-week long structured program where a student is asked to identify a social problem and work out a solution about it and interact with the stakeholders and give them a solution. So this is the way you better know your society around. You better know your human problems around you. And this increases your solutioning skills, basically. Similarly, your personality enhancement program, or PEP, that gives you, in a structured fashion, in a credit bound manner. It is not an effort which is not assessed. It's an effort which is assessed. And you are geared into know your body, know your mind, know others, and acquire relevant communication, analytical, and, you know, professional skills about it. So just to give you how Vijayabhoomi is facilitating the self-discovery and subsequent to that acquisition of specialized skills. For example, a student who is entering into a BBA can choose to be an entrepreneur, can major in entrepreneurship, can conceive a business at Vijayabhoomi, and then can study all relevant skills. For example, if it is requiring a design, one can choose majors in design or data science or artificial intelligence. Whatever is your requirement, the university provides that enabling framework that you can pursue your professional pursuits. On that note, can I have your reflection as to how this kind of approach to education is going to serve our youth?
I mean, I think this is firstly, honestly, pretty awesome. I don't think I would, I ever had as awesome an education in terms of the curriculum that you guys have. I think the two things that really stand out, and in fact, actually, a lot of what I said, you all already do, but I'm guessing that's an exception and that's not a norm, is indeed, that, you know, I think that there is a great amount of agility and flexibility that you all are offering students, which I think is really amazing. And it's a very common theme in the US, where, you know, people aren't herded into narrow subject lines when their mind and they're still discovering themselves. So I think that, you know, you guys have that completely on point. And I think the second thing, and I would encourage all the students listening, is take futuristic courses. Amazing to hear that y'all are offering courses on design, data science, AI. You know, this is the future. Knowing what is a joint stock company and what is a partnership is just not, it's not even knowledge in my opinion anymore. Like, you have to be building relevant skills for the future. And these are the skills that you should build, which, you know, others may not have access to in the market. And trust me, these skills are in super high demand.
It has been a great pleasure to receive your questions, dear participants. And at the end, I must thank Dhwanil Sheth. Thank you very much for taking time out and spending this time on this conversation. I think this has been a very, very meaningful conversation. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. It's a true honor.